better than, it's a little better than that, so I guess we're moving forward. Let me hear from Sister Sonia next.
Well, I made a massive mistake and did a paper, so I'm going to kind of edit it, okay? Because I thought we were going to do that. But I want to say to all the people here that you should make us all millionaires.
Yeah!
Every time a black person publishes a book here, we should automatically have a system where we go out and buy those books. Okay, why not? Why not? I'm serious about this. Why not? And even don't tell me I don't like that writer. I buy books about people I don't like also, okay? But why? I support them, so therefore, at the end of the year, they will indeed be supported. We should do that. Make all of us millionaires and people who give back to the community. That's important. I did a couple of things. I want to begin with a joke. Three jokes, actually. One that my father tells about the first black power in America. My father, who just turned 96, on this year, so he's really only 24. He tells about the first black power, which happened in a place called LaGuardia, New York City, after World War II. People got on the plane, and they happened to look in the cockpit door, and they saw this black guy sitting there. The people sat down and stopped pushing the button. At that time, they called people, the women, stewardess. They said, stewardess. Is that a Negro in there? And she said, just a minute. There's no problem. Just wait a minute. Sit down. I'll go inside and talk to the captain. She goes inside. She says, Jack, I told you to close the door. The people have seen you, and now there's a problem. He said, don't worry, Janie. I'll get on the intercom. And he does. He says, good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Captain Jack Jones. I am your pilot for our trip to LA today. But before I begin, let me tell you just a little bit about myself. I am a graduate of Harvard University. I'm also a graduate of Yale University. I'm also a graduate of MIT. I'm also a graduate of Oxford University, and then during World War II, I taught all of the pilots how to fly. So if you could just settle down and calm down, I will see if I can be big mother off the ground. I'm going to get children here, I'm sorry. Mother off the ground. We understand what that is about. It's about us having to be better than everybody else. You know, always. And I listen very carefully to my father. The second joke, which has been prevalent within the last 5 or so years. Question, what's the hardest 12 years in a black guy's life? Answer, third grade. A black guy was stranded on a desert island. Bottle rolls up. Genie gets out. The genie says, you have two wishes. And the black guy says, I want to be white. And the genie says, poof, and he's white. And then he says, you have a second wish. He says, I don't want to ever have to work a day in my life again. He says, poof, you're black. Hold at banquet, mind you. And people go whoa and roar. And the difference between the first joke and the last two jokes are very relevant, very important. Are they not? Oh, yes, they are. You better believe so. So what I did is that I did like these sections. I'm going to hold them down so we won't be forever. Some personal history. Well, I believe the poet is a creator of social values. Social values bring from human interaction with the environment and are the result of perception of that experience. The environment of man, woman is all the suggestions which surround the mind and impact it as it pursues human survival, awareness, understanding of itself, its place in society and the universe. Environment suggestions around the mind create impressions within the mind of which the social personality is formed. The collective experience of people who interact with the same environment form a worldview, i.e., a version of life by which the significance of all thought and action by members of the society are weighed. This worldview emerges first in the language and symbol, and then in all of society's institutions. But with the birth of symbol, the birth of the poet is announced. Language itself, in a broad sense, is a symbol of the thought interaction of a people. Although it is designed primarily to communicate experiences in fundamental ways, Poetry, on the other hand, is the symbol or essence of language, designed to sensitize meaning, motivate, create, or recreate experience, and bestow a state of perception not ordinarily experienced or not experienced in an ordinary way. The poet, even though she, he speaks plainly, is a manipulator of symbols and language images, which have been planted by experience in the collective subconscious of a people. Through this manipulation, he, she creates new or intensified meaning and experience, whether to the benefit or detriment of his, her audience. Thus, poems is what I call a subconscious conversation. It is as much the work of those who understand it and those who make it. Continuation. What to tell you how I have become, became this woman with razor blades between her teeth. I first started to write after my grandmother died when I was 6 years of age. Because of her, I became tongue-tied, her death, I became tongue-tied as a stutterer. I'm a child who ran with the boys, climbed trees and fought, and tasted the wind in my eyes. I wrote privately and secretly for years. This private self became the public self when I discovered all of the pain and rage inside of me had a tertiary history. All of the silence had been superimposed on me, and I wrote because I discovered Du Bois's double consciousness. It is a peculiar sensation, this double consciousness, this sense of always looking at oneself through the eyes of others, of measuring one's souls by the tape of a world that looks on in amused contempt and pity. One ever feels his two-ness, an American, a Negro, two souls, two thoughts, two unreconciled strivings, two warring ideals in one dark body, whose darkest strength alone keeps it from being torn asunder. So I wrote early, come into black geography. You, seated like Manzu Cardinal, come up through tongues multiplying memories, and to avoid descent among wounds, cruising like ships, climb into these sockets, golden brine. Because I was born positioned to black race, I cut a blue song for America. And you, cushioned by middle class springs, saw ghettos that stretched voices into dust, turned corners where people walked on their faces. I sang unbending gods and gathered gods convenient as Christ. I am the frozen phase. Here my face marches towards new myths while spring runs green with ghosts. I am the living mass. Here my skin warm with adolescence peels like Picasso's planes, and the earth in one fold of permanence stares at the skies. If I had a big piece of dust to ride on, I would gather up my pulse and follow disposable dreams. And all things being equal, they would pass into butterflies and quiver and sprawling yellow. And so, I went then to a place called Hunter College at NYU, met Louise Vogan at NYU, went and sat in on her class by the door ready to leave if this experience turned out badly. And I stayed with this aristocratic voice woman who listened to a piece of mine and began to teach us how to write for form. I started to write and got published in small magazines, began to teach, heard the country, cried out for sanity in the midst of insanity, joined New York Corps, began a search for me, and MLK came, and Malcolm came. In the 1960s, the question of black identity was addressed head on. The turning of black to beautiful came into prominence in 1959. Black pride emerged as a social value on the lips of poets, in the lyrics of musicians, the stories of novelists, in the environmental trappings of black life from hairdos to sandals, from jazz or black classical music to Kwanzaa. A black aesthetic emerged which took identity from the black nationalist movement of Elijah Muhammad and Malcolm X and others. A chief characteristic of this awareness was the changing of names to African Islamic one. Example, Leroy Jones became Amida Baraka, Don Lee Hakim Adebuti, Roland Snellens Asiya Muhammad Ture, Jewel Lattimore Johara Amini, James Ngugi Wa Thiong'o, etc., etc., etc. And to the thick of it then, in the souls of black folk, W.B. Du Bois discussed the existence of a duality within black life. This duality, this double consciousness, came to mean for many of us as activists, writers, teachers, leaders, the existence of ambiguities and vacillations between assimilationist and nationalist tendencies in black life. This early discussion of double consciousness was shaped by the 1960s ideological debates between the so-called separatist Nation of Islam and the so-called integrationist NAACP called SCLC. This was a necessary discussion, I think, for the understanding of black cultural and political dualities. For many, this double consciousness was used to describe, refer to the informal ability of some blacks to negotiate the veil, go back and forth, forth and back, without dire consequences. And also it referred to the internal conflict of values among some blacks who had been socialized in both black and white worlds. So for Du Bois, at the turn of the century, the principal dilemma of blacks was, and I quote, blacks must live a double life as blacks and as Americans, that such a living of a double life would generate double thoughts, double duties, double social classes, and would give rise to double words and double ideals. This would give rise to a painful self-consciousness, an almost morbid sense of personality, and a moral hesitancy, which is fatal to self-confidence. It would give rise to certain unspecified aspects of two-ness, were positive and should be preserved. In the merging of his double self into a better and truer self, the Negro wishes neither of the older selves to be lost. Also, five, education would provide the key to the resolution of the negative aspect of two-ness by exonerating and saving the race and making racist, rational people who understood the problems. One of Du Bois' most important pieces was the allegory, The Company of John, which showed us the double consciousness, finally, of the educated black class and how this education had anticipated the problem. And I quote that part of that piece about John Jones returning home, right? And he came home to educate his black children. He opened a school, Du Bois says. It was a thankless job, the school. The Negroes were rent into factions for and against him. The parents were careless, the children irregular and dirty, and books, pencils, slates largely missing. Nevertheless, he struggled hopefully on and seemed to see at last some glimmering of dawn. The Coming of John is also an example of the literal double consciousness of America. Two worlds, one black John, one white John, what we had to come across in the 1960s. And I go on to talk about the alienation then, I'm cutting, the alienation that happened there also, the alienation that cut the black John off from the culture of his people. One night while speaking at a church, he spoke some negative words about religion, and an old man, the blues character of our past, ago times, arose like a phoenix out of the bosom of the South. He says, I want to tell you, I want to tell you about him and how I loves him and he loves me and how we walks together and talks together and bends together, and eats together, and be together forever. And now he's in this room watching us and how I know he lives, he ain't dead, never died, never could die. It's here in the wood, the flow, the candles, the Lord forgive him, for he know not what he do. Amen, amen, amen. Oh my Lord, Lord, Lord. John never knew clearly what the old man said. He only felt himself held up for scorn and scathing denunciation for trampling on the true religion. And he realized with amazement that all unknowingly he had put rough hands on something this little world held sacred. He arose silently and passed out into the night. Then I talk about the white John's discontentment also too. This double consciousness gave birth to what I call the twins of the black educated selves, the physical and cultural mulattoes, and the single birth of secondary consciousness that included all of us, the educated class and also the poor class. And then I talk about cultural mulattoes and dualism there also, the physical mulatto, and what we see about this double consciousness. And I go on to talk about Frederick Douglass, thank God for making him a man, but Marjolaine, thank God for making him a black man. And what that meant in terms of the double consciousness expressed by a man by the name of Delaney, who talks about immigration and struggle at home, a different kind of double consciousness. But we also see the manifestation of this double consciousness today in American society when we see the Sambo, or what I call Bro Rabbit, and Nat Turner in our literature. And if you really read your literature carefully, you'll see the Sambo out there and the Bro Rabbit. You see the hustlers out there hustling, you know, in a great sense. And by the Sambo also, too, all the way from the black Republicans to the comedic tips. You know, I mean, come on, people. That guy running for president, that black guy running for president, it was unbelievable. You tell me, you had to see it also too. That brother who does Boondocks is an amazing, do you ever see Boondocks? When he held up that brother and said, like, you know, like he had, like, disappeared before our eyes, right? It was an amazing, amazing thing, if you really understand that. But again, the Sambos, you know, and the Broad Rabbits, and the Nat Turners in our literature, the community activists, you know, the people who do the satire here, the Baracas, the Mosleys, who will give us Socrates, the Ish and his satire, the Queen Latifah, the Laura, the Brother Talib, and Ngugi, and Devil of the Cross, the poetry of rappers, Mos Def, Rakim, Chuck D, Roots, you know, all of these people, if you truly understand what I'm talking about, you talk about the Nat Turners in our literature, saying out loud on these radios, and sometimes we don't pay attention to them, we just kind of like ignore them.